morning, dear sisters and brothers. Welcome to Daybreak. Every day is a precious gift of our loving God to us. So we ought to thank and praise Him for His infinite love for us. Let us now join the choir in thanking and praising Him.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship You. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. In love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. Worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, bless Him, O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. I'll worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, I'll worship Your holy name, Jesus. I worship Your holy name. I'll worship Your holy name.
stories, life, or events of certain people convey profound lessons to us. So, let us tune our ears to listen to one such anecdote.
Friends, morning has broken, and let us make this day with a virtue embedded in our hearts. There was once a lion who happened to live among the flock of sheep. The lion never knew that he was a lion, and so he would bleat like a sheep. And he would eat grass like a sheep. And he would spend the whole time among the sheep. One day, the sheep went out for pasturing near the edge of a jungle. While they were pasturing, a forest lion jumped out of the jungle and ran into the flock of the sheep. And the sheep all ran away into different directions, afraid of the lion, and they saved themselves. The lion, which grew up among the sheep, also ran away. But the forest lion went after the lion, which was among the sheep, and caught hold of him. And so, the country lion knelt down before the forest lion and knelt and begged him, "Please spare my life." And the forest lion caught him by the skin and pulled him to a nearby lake and asked the country lion to look into the water and see for himself the reflection of his image. And the country lion looked into the water, and he looked at the face of the forest lion again and again, and finally he understood the similarity of them two. And then, understanding himself, he gave out a big roar for the first time in his life. He roared as a lion, and he never was a sheep again. My dear friends, today, from this story, we need to ask ourselves, do we know who we are? Do we understand what we are supposed to be? And in the Greek philosophy, the first thought that is inculcated into the minds of the people is nothing but know yourself. And in psychology, everything about the study of man will begin with this thought, know yourself. And this is exactly what Jesus came to tell the human beings, who you are and what you are supposed to be, is the lesson taught by Jesus, because he knew that none of us are living fully to the full capacity, to the full growth that we are supposed to have in our life. We rarely realize our potential. We rarely realize our strength. We rarely realize the beauty that is lying within us. And so, most of the time, we live as if we do not know ourselves. We continue to live on earth knowing who we actually ought to be. And that is why Jesus would remind us, recognize who we are and for what we are. And he would remind us the very first intention that God had in creating us. And that is what we see in the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 27. So God created man in his image. In the image of God, he created him. And so this is the beauty that we have within ourselves. The beauty of God's image and likeness. And this is what we do not realize often. And so we do not live up to the expected growth and maturity that we should have. In the Gospel of St. John, chapter 1, verse 12, once again we understand who we are in the light of Christ's teaching. This is what the word says. He came to his own, to all those who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God. And so, we are not only the image and likeness of God, the children of God. And that is why Saint Irenaeus once said, the glory of God is man fully alive. Let this be the virtue that we embed in our hearts today.
Certainly, the anecdote you have just listened to has conveyed a message for your life. Saints were ordinary people like you and me, but they had an extraordinary desire to lead a holy life. The Catholic Church has several saints. Let us now listen to the life of the saint of the day.
St. Lawrence was baptized Julius Caesar Russo at Brindisi in Italy and was a true general of God. He was a Capuchin who dedicated his many talents to the church during the Reformation century. A born preacher, he studied to become cultured and conversant in French, German, Greek, Syriac, and Hebrew. As a worker in the Catholic renewal, he preached throughout all Central Europe, campaigned against the Turks in Hungary, and was an able diplomat. He was only 12 when his father died, and his widowed mother lavished all her affection on Julius, her only child. Spiritual things attracted Julius from his earliest years, and his neighbors frequently called him the little angel. When sometime later he wished to enter the monastery, his mother felt crushed. Finally, moved by the grace of God, she gave her consent. First, he entered a diocesan seminary in Venice, seeking to develop himself spiritually through total detachment, absolute poverty, and rigorous fasts. In 1575, he sought out the bearded followers of Francis Assisi, entering the Capuchin novitiate at 16. There he received the name Brother Lawrence of Brindisi. He entered into the austerities of Capuchin life wholeheartedly. Even as a youth, he gave proof of great zeal and added rigors of his own to the austerities of the rule. Imprudent zeal and an infection of the chest brought on sleepless nights. It was feared by older friars that he would not be able to bear the rigors of Capuchin life. He passed for his profession by just one oath. Though his adult life was to be a story of sickness, his health improved in time to admit him to solemn profession in 1576. Lawrence made his philosophical and theological studies at the University of Padua, and in 1582 was ordained a priest. An excellent memory enabled him to master not only the principal European languages, but also most of the Semitic tongues. It was said he knew the entire original text of the Bible. This knowledge, in the eyes of many, could be accounted for only by supernatural assistance. The unusual talents of Lawrence and his rare virtue fitted him for the most diverse missions. When still a deacon, he preached the Lenten sermons in Venice, and his success was so great that he was called to all the principal cities of the peninsula. His numerous journeys enabled him to evangelize at different periods most of the countries of Europe. Despite all his traveling, preaching, and diplomatic missions, St. Lawrence wrote some 800 sermons which were finally published in 1928. Then modern scholars understood why the faith, zeal, and the scholarship of the humble Capuchin had been praised in his time. He sought in his sermons to reach men's heart and convert them, and on all occasions he adapted his style to the spiritual needs of his hearers. From 1596 to 1602, he lived in Rome as Vicar General of the Capuchins. Here Pope Clement VIII asked him to instruct converts among the Jews. His knowledge of the Hebrew language helped him lead many to recognize the truth of the Christian religion. His saintliness brought the grace of conversion to many, and the Holy Father sent him to other cities where he was equally successful in attracting the Jews to follow Christ. He was assigned to establish Capuchin houses in Germany and Austria. His reputation for holiness had gone before him, and the people came long distance to hear him preach and to receive his blessings. His administration was categorized by wise firmness and fatherly tenderness. The year 1605 marked the end of his term as Vicar General. Lawrence was now sent by the Pope to evangelize Germany. His saintliness and numerous miracles led to many conversions. The Catholic princes of Germany formed an alliance called the Catholic League. The Emperor Rudolf sent Lawrence to Philip II of Spain to persuade him to join the League. The mission accomplished, Lawrence received a double mandate: to represent the interests of Pope at Madrid and at the court of Maximilian of Bavaria. Lawrence was both nuncio and ambassador. When disagreement rose among the Catholic princes, his diplomacy restored harmony among them. For a second time, he conducted a missionary campaign throughout Germany and traveled for 8 months. Only a dedicated apostle could have found time amid his various undertakings for the practice of personal sanctification. His biographers have left us no doubt regarding his intense inner life in the practice of the religious virtues. He had to a high degree of gift of contemplation and very rarely celebrated Holy Mass without falling into ecstasies. After the Holy Sacrifice, his great devotion was the Rosary and the office of the Blessed Virgin. In 1618, Lawrence was hoping to enjoy a few days of seclusion in his monastery, but was requested by the leading men of Naples to go to Spain and tell Philip III of the conduct of Viceroy Osuna. In spite of many obstacles raised by the latter, the saint sailed from Genoa and carried out his mission successfully. But the fatigues of the journey exhausted his feeble strength. He was unable to travel homeward, and after a few days of great suffering, died at Lisbon on July 22, 1619, as he had predicted when he set out on his journey. He was beatified in 1783 by Pope Pius VI, canonized in 1881 by Pope Leo XIII, and declared an apostolic doctor of the Church by Pope John XXIII in 1959. He is the first Capuchin Franciscan thus to be honored, the third doctor of the entire Franciscan family. Let us pray. Lord, for the glory of your name and the salvation of souls, you gave Lawrence of Brindisi courage and right judgment. By his prayers, help us to know what we should do and give us the courage to do it. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us remember in our prayers this day all farmers who depend upon the land for their sustenance. O Lord, we lift up to you all farmers and their families and those who labor for them. Please bless them with a good harvest, and may they always remain close and faithful to you. We ask this through the intercession of your Mother Mary. Amen.
After listening to the life of the saint of the day, aren't you inspired to lead a new life of holiness? Thy word is a lamp unto my feet. Yes, Lord, your word is indeed the light to my path. Dear sisters and brothers, let us now listen to today's Bible reflection through Daily Bread.
Let me first read the passage and then we shall reflect on it. The Pharisees went out and took counsel against him how to destroy him. Jesus, aware of this, withdrew from there. And many followed him, and he healed them all and ordered them not to make him known. This was to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah. Behold, my servant whom I have chosen, my beloved, with whom my soul is well pleased. I will put my spirit upon him, and he shall proclaim justice to the Gentiles. He will not wrangle or cry out, nor will anyone hear his voice in the streets. He will not break a bruised reed or quench a smoldering wick till he brings justice to victory. And in his name will the Gentiles hope. This is the word of the Lord. Praise the Lord. Dear friends, the reading today presents before us a totally different picture of Jesus. It starts with saying that Jesus withdrew from there. It is the Gospel of Matthew. And the Gospel of Matthew has already reported once that Jesus withdrew. That was when it was reported that John the Baptist was arrested, as in Matthew 4:12. And it's after that Jesus comes to Galilee and starts his proclamation. Now, when it is reported that the Pharisees went out and plotted to kill him, Jesus withdraws from there. That's what we said, and he withdrew. Again, we hear Jesus withdrawing when it was reported that John the Baptist was beheaded by Herod Antipas. So this is a particular type of activity. Jesus not going to confront, not going to attack, but somehow withdrawing. And this does not correspond to a messianic image that the Jews were keeping in mind. The most well-known messianic prophecies were about a Davidic king, a son of David, who, like David, would lead the nation to victory in conflict and war, a world-dominating Messiah, or a prophet like Moses, who would also be manifesting the power. They did not think of a weak Messiah who will withdraw, a Messiah who suffers. And this is what Jesus is now presenting. And Matthew tells us that this was in fulfillment of a prophecy that was not much known or expected at that time, a prophecy about the suffering servant. In fact, this is one of the lines of messianic expectation, though not very popular, but accepted and understood by the Christian community, especially after the death and resurrection of Jesus, the servant prophet. And there are, in fact, four songs called the servant songs. That's in the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapters 42, 1 to 9, the first song, 49, 1 to 6, the second song, chapter 50, 4 to 11, the third messianic song, and chapter 52, 13 to 53, 12, that is the fourth Yabeth Yahweh song, servant song. And these songs present a very particular picture of the Messiah, a peaceful, quiet, suffering person who does not confront, who is meek, and who brings the salvation, the message, not only to the Jews, but also to the Gentiles. And there's a particular style of his work. It is said, he will not shout or cry out, nor will anyone hear his voice. It's a humble servant leadership, the servant Messiah. And that's what Jesus is. And that's what Jesus wants his disciples also to be. The servant was called, anointed by the Spirit. And he was sent out to the Gentiles, to all the nations, to bring the good news, to be a light to the nations. And his life will be somehow a life of suffering. And that's why finally we call the suffering servant. The last song, chapter 52, 13 to 53, 12, this is one of the most important biblical passages considered by the church, by the Gospels and Acts and letters as fulfilled in Jesus Christ. He was a suffering servant. He did not open his mouth. He did not grumble. He did not fight. He took upon himself the sins of the world. That's what John the Baptist was telling. Behold the Lamb of God who takes up the sin of the world, who takes away the sins of the world. So Jesus, who sacrificed himself out of love and compassion for the sinful humanity, and through his death gave us life. So this is what Jesus is giving, and that is the message that today we are given. But this may be a message not very palatable to many, because we are used to power, dominate, and be a powerful, dominating community, church, and those who are power, those who are leaders, those who are wealthy, and those who have status in the society, they are considered to be leaders, and we are not that willing to be a servant. But that is exactly what Jesus wants us to be. I have given you an example at the Last Supper. Jesus said, kneeling down before the disciples, washing their feet as the servant or slave should be doing, and then Jesus said, I have given an example so that you may do as I have done. You call me Master and Lord, and it's true, I am your Master and your Lord. If I, your Master and Lord, have washed your feet, you should wash each other's feet. So the feet washing authority, a servant discipleship, that's what is expected of us. That's what, fortunately, present Pope Francis is telling and showing by his example. The example of servant leadership. And I think we, especially in the church and the leaders, have to learn it, learn more from the servant leadership of Jesus, the meek and humble, the one who becomes a light to the nations by his self-surrender. The lamp burns and becomes light by burning itself. So the self-emptying, kenotic life of Jesus should be the model for all of us. If you want to be a disciple of Jesus, he should be like him. Let us ask the Lord for this grace to understand this kenotic, self-emptying leadership of Jesus and the servant Messiah that Jesus was. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great gift of your Son, who gave us an example of love and servant leadership. Lord Jesus, you who chose your disciples and gave the example to be a servant rather than dominating on the others, give us also the strength, the courage, and the love to imitate, to do as you have done, to be servants of your brothers and sisters. This prayer we make through Christ our Lord. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I hope that today's Bible reflection has given you new insights and enriched you spiritually. As we come to the end of this episode of Daybreak, let us once again thank the Lord with this beautiful hymn.
God is good all the time. He put this song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, his light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time. God is good all the time. He put this song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, his light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time. If you're walking through the valley, there are shadows all around. Do not fear, he will guide you. He will keep you safe and sound. He has promised to never leave you or forsake you. And his word is true. God is good all the time. Put this song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time.
Through the darkest night, His light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time. God is good. God is good all the time.
Dear sisters and brothers, I believe that the last half an hour has really been a blessing for you. Until we meet again, stay blessed.